Hi, in this presentation, we are going to see gate previous year questions with answers for electrical engineering, okay, power systems, set number 5. In this set, we are going to see 10 different questions from various years. First question, this particular question is asked in the year 2008. A lossless power system has to serve a load of 250 megawatt. There are two generators G1 and G2 with system characteristics C1 and C2, okay. And C1 they have given C1 equal to Pg1 plus 0.055 Pg1 square. C2 equal to 3 Pg2 plus 0.03 Pg2 square. Whereas Pg1, Pg2 are the megawatt injections from the generator G1 and G2 respectively. Then the minimum cost dispatch will be, okay. They have given the total load as 250 megawatt and they have given the cost characteristics for generator 1 and generator 2. Okay, first we have to find out the incremental cost for generator 1. Okay, DC1 by DP1 equal to by differentiating PG1 will get 1, by differentiating 0.055 PG1 square will get 2 into 0.055 PG1. So 2 into 0.055 is 0.11. okay, and in similarly for incremental cost of generator 2 is DC2 by DP2 equal to 3 plus 0.06 into P2. For economic operation, incremental cost of generator 1 should be equal to the incremental cost of generator 2. By equating, we can get one equation. Okay, and total load is 250 megawatt. So P1 plus P2 equal to 250 megawatt. So we get another equation. By solving these two equations, we'll get the actual value. P1 equal to 100, P2 equal to 150. So choice C is the right answer. Okay, and I'm repeating, they have given the lossless power system. In the power system, the total load is 250 megawatt. Okay, they have given the cost characteristics for generator 1 and they have given the cost characteristics for generator 2 and they have asked you to find out the minimum cost dispatch. Okay, for finding out the minimum cost dispatch, incremental cost of generator 1 and generator 2 should be equal. So we have to find the incremental cost for generator 1, we have to find the incremental cost for generator 2 and we have to equate it. Then you get one equation. And total load is P1 plus P2 equal to 250 megawatt. So you got another equation. By solving the equation 1 and 2, we'll get the answer. Okay. A 100 MVA, 11 kV, 3 phase, 50 Hz, 8 pole synchronous generator has an inertia constant H equal to 4 seconds. The stored energy in the rotor of the generator at synchronous speed will be H equal to E by G. Okay. What will be the answer? So they have given, it is an 100 MVA and they have given the inertia constant also. Okay, inertia constant equal to kinetic energy stored in the rotor in megajoules divided by machine rating in MVA. We know the inertia constant is 4 and kinetic energy stored is what we have to find out. Okay, machine rating is 100. By substituting, we will get the kinetic energy stored is 400 megajoules. Okay, again I am repeating. They are given a 100 MVA, 11 kV, 3 phase, 50 Hz, 8 pole synchronous generator has an inertia constant of H equal to 4 seconds and they asked you to find out the stored energy in the rotor. Okay, inertia constant equal to kinetic energy stored in the rotor divided by machine rating in MVA. So we know that kinetic energy stored, like we know that, sorry, we know that inertia constant is 4 and we have to find out the kinetic energy stored. Okay, we know the machine rating. By substituting, we'll get the answer. Next question. A power station consists of two synchronous generators A and B of rating 250 MVA and 500 MVA with inertia 1.6 per unit and 1 per unit respectively on their own base KVA, base MVA ratings. The equivalent per unit inertia constant for the system on 100 MVA common base. So they have given two generators 250 MVA and 500 MVA. The inertia constant is 1.6 per unit and 1 per unit. Okay, they asked you to find out for 100 MVA base. Okay, we know that inertia constant equal to kinetic energy stored in the rotor divided by machine rating in MVA. So inertia constant is inversely proportional to the machine rating. Okay, so we'll form a formula like H nu by H volt equal to MVA volt by MVA nu. So H nu by H volt means inertia constant of new machine is inversely proportional to the inertia constant of new rating. Inertia constant of old will be inversely proportional to the MVA rating of old. Okay. So by finding out HA equal to 1.6 into 250 by 100. So we'll get 4 per unit. And HB equal to 1 into 500 by 100, 5 per unit. So H equal to HA plus HB. So we will get 4 plus 5 is 9 per unit. Okay. Again I am repeating. They have given a two synchronous generators A and B. Okay. A is having a rating of 250 MVA and B is having a rating of 500 MVA. Okay. They have given the per unit is 1.6 per unit and 1 per unit. So they are given in own base rating. Okay. So you have to convert the equivalent per unit in 100 MVA common base. Okay. For finding out that, we know that inertia constant H equal to kinetic energy stored in the rotor divided by machine rating in MVA. Inertia constant is inversely proportional to the machine rating. So inertia constant of nu equal to inertia constant of nu divided by inertia constant of old equal to MVA rating of old by MVA nu. So by substituting we will get the answer. Next, consider the problem of relay coordination for the distance relays R1 and R2 on adjacent lines of the transmission system. The zone 1 and zone 2 settings for the both the relays are indicated in the diagram. Which of the following indicates the correct time setting for zone 2 and zone 1? Okay, they have given the zone 1 R1, zone 1 R2 and zone 2 R1, zone 2 R2. Okay, so by seeing this we can say that zone 2 R1 and zone 2 R2 are overlapped. Okay, so we can easily see that zone 2 R1 and zone 2 R2 are overlapped, and fault in the zone 2, okay, R2 should trip faster than the R1. So the tripping characteristics for R2 should have less timing, and tripping characteristics for R1 will have little higher timing. So here from this we can see in B, R2 is having higher characteristics, so B is not the right answer. And they have told both are equal timing in C, so it is not right. And D also, R2 is higher, so this is not right. So choice A is the right answer. Okay. Again I am repeating. Consider the problem of relay coordination for the distance relay R1 and R2 on adjacent lines of the transmission system. The zone 1 and zone 2 settings for the both relays are indicated in the diagram. Which of the following indicates the correct time setting for the zone 2 and zone 1? Zone 2 relays of R1 and R2. Okay. From this we can see that zone 2 R1 and zone 2 R2 are overlapped. Okay. The timing for zone 2 R2 should be lesser than the zone 2 R1. Okay. So choice A is the right answer. Generally relay coordination will be done in two ways. One is time graded principle, another is current graded principle. Actually in time graded principle, the faulty system, there will be an incremental time setting will be there. This is a time graded principle. In current graded principle, the current setting will be set at incremental values. Okay. The concept of electrically short, medium and long line is primarily based on. So they are given four choices: nominal voltage of the line, physical length of the line, wavelength of the line, power transmitted over the line. Okay. So generally the concept of electrically short, medium, long is primarily based on the physical length of the transmission line. Generally there are three categories are there. Short transmission line is up to 60 km and less than 20 kV voltage. Medium is 60 km to 160 km up to 100 kV. Long transmission line is above 160 km, okay, and more than 100 kV. Again, I am repeating. The concept of electrical short, medium, long lines primarily based on, okay, physical length of the line. Okay, so physical length is normally for short transmission line is up to 60 km and less than 20 kV. Medium transmission line 60 to 160 and between 20 to 100 kV. For long transmission line is more than 160 and more than 100 kV. In some books they have mentioned that short transmission line is up to 50, medium transmission line is up to 250, long transmission line is above 250. Like that also in some books they have mentioned it. Okay. Next question. A 400 volt 50 hertz 3-phase balanced source supplies a power to the star connected load whose rating is 12√3 kVA, 0.8 power factor lag. The rating of the delta connected reactive power bank necessary to bring the power factor to unities. So they have given one load. Okay, they have asked you to install a capacitor. Okay, what will be the rating of KVA? What will be the rating of KVR? Okay, capacitor KVR to bring the load to the unity power factor. So what we have to do is, first we have to find out the KVR demand of the system. Okay, so first we have to find out the KVA demand of the system. After finding out the KVA demand, then we have to see for unity power factor the KVR should be zero. So the total KVR should be delivered by the capacitor. Okay, KVA demand of this one is, sorry, I have made a small mistake. Actually, it is 12√3. Okay, I have mentioned 10√3. Okay, 12√3 into sine angle. Okay, if you put for 0.8 power factor, it will be 36.86. It will be 12.47 kilowatt. So KVR demand for unity power factor is zero. Okay, the total value of 12.47 has to be catered by the capacitor bank. Okay, again I am repeating, they have given the 400 volt, 50 hertz, 3-phase balanced source supply power to the star connected load whose rating is 12√3, 0.8 power factor lag. The rating of delta connected reactive power bank necessary to bring the power factor to unity. So they have given the load. So first we have to find out what is the reactive power requirement of the system. So the total reactive power requirement of the system is to be met by using a capacitor. If the capacitor meets the total reactive power requirement, then it will be unity power factor. Okay, so we'll find the KVR demand of 0.8 equal to 12√3, 1.732 sine 36.86. okay, 12.47 KVR. okay, next question. Consider 3-core 3-phase 50 hertz 11 kV cable whose conductors are denoted by R, Y, B in the figure. The interface capacitance is, C1 is 0.2 microfarad. The capacitance between the line conductor and the sheath is 0.4 microfarad. The per phase charging current is, so they have given the value of C1 and C2 and they have asked you to find out the per phase value of the current. Okay, first for finding out the per phase value, we have to find out the equivalent capacitance value. Okay, from this we can see that there are three C1s are there. C1, it is between RB and between RY and between BY. All the three are in parallel actually. So if you see this in parallel, we said that for parallel capacitance, the value has to be added. So we'll get 3C1. Okay, so we'll get a 3C1 and this is a single C2. C2, because we are going to find out per phase. So C2 plus 3C1. Okay, we know that C2 is 0.4 and C1 is 0.2. So by substituting this, we'll get the equivalent capacitance value per phase. This is 1 microfarad. So per phase charging current equal to V phase into omega into C phase. So V phase is 11√3. Okay, for KVA I have put at 1000. Okay, into 2 pi, 2 into 1.414 into 50. Omega, actually instead of omega, 2 pi f I have to put into 10⁻⁶, 2 amps. 2 amps is the right answer. Okay, again I am repeating, they have given the 3 core 3 phase 50 hertz 11 kb cable whose conductors are denoted by R, Y, B. Okay, the interface capacitance C1 value is 0.2 and capacitance between each line conductor is sheath is 0.4. okay, we have to find out the per phase charging current. For finding out the per phase charging current, we have to find the equivalent capacitance first. For equivalent capacitance, we know that capacitance per phase is, actually if the capacitance are connected in parallel, it should be added. If the capacitance are connected in series, actually it is opposite to the resistance. Actually, okay, capacitance per phase C2 plus 3C1. Okay, we'll find the actual capacitance, then per phase charging current. Okay, by substituting, we'll get the answer. Next. Series capacitive compensation EHV lines is used to, the purpose of series capacitive compensation in extra high voltage transmission line is to improve the stability of the system. So generally the purpose of series capacitive compensation is to increase the power transfer capability of the system, improvement in the system stability, load division among the parallel lines and control of the voltage. sudden collapse of the voltage can be avoided. Okay, the purpose of series capacitance is increase the power transfer capability, improvement in system stability, load division among the parallel lines, and sudden collapse of the voltage can be avoided, that is controlling of the voltage. Okay, the question is series capacitive compensation in EHV transmission line is used to, okay, improve the stability of the system. Answer B is right. So generally it will be used for increasing the power transfer capability, improvement in system stability, load division among the parallel line, control of voltage. Okay, next question. For a fixed value of complex power flow in the transmission line having a sending end voltage is V, the real power loss will be proportional to, okay, so whether it is proportional to the voltage or voltage square or 1 by V square, 1 by V. Okay, so power equal to I square into R. Okay, so instead of I, I am substituting S by root 3 V. Okay, so into R, so S square R by 3 V square, so it is proportional to 1 by V square. Again, I am repeating, for a fixed value of complex power in the transmission line having a sending end voltage of V, the real power loss will be proportional to. So first we have to find out the real power loss, and we have to see whether it is proportional to the V or V square or 1 by V square or 1 by V. So right answer is 1 by V square. Power equal to I square into R. Instead of I am putting S by root 3 V. So I am squaring then into R, S square R by 3 V square. So choice C is the right answer. Next question. Consider the transformer connections in a part of power system is shown in the figure. The nature of transformer connections and phase shift are indicated in all but one transformer. Okay, for that transformer you have to find out. Okay, here they have shown one generating station at 15 kV. Okay, they have shown one transformer in delta star connection and 30 degree phase shift, and it is connected to the 400 kV transmission line. Okay, and they have mentioned one auto transformer with 0 degree phase shift. Okay, and then they have mentioned one more transformer from 15 kV delta Y transformer with 30 degree phase shift, and they have shown another transformer AB, and they have not mentioned any phase shift, or they have not mentioned any type of transformer. Okay, and it is connected to the 220 kV. So they have asked you to find out which of the following conditions and the corresponding phase shift theta should be used for the transformer between A and B. So they asked you to find out what is the correct suitable transformer here. Okay, they are given star star, star delta, delta star, star zigzag with angles. Okay, first we have to see the transformer AB should not give any phase shift, because we already seen that from the 15 kV 30 degree phase shift is there. Okay, 13 degree phase shift is there because of the delta Y transformer. Okay, this 13 degree phase shift, and it is 0 because it is auto transformer. There is no phase shift here. In 220 kV also, there should be only 30 degree phase shift. There should not be any other additional phase shift. Okay, and we already have a delta Y transformer with 30 degree phase shift, and it is connected here. Okay, so AB transformer should be star connection. Primary also should be star, secondary also should be star, and there should not be any phase shift. So theta should be 0. So choice A is the right answer. Again, I am repeating. Consider the transformer connections in the part of the power system shown in the figure. The nature of transformer connections and phase shift are indicated for all but in one transformer. So this is a 15 kV system. From the 15 kV system, two lines are going. One line is going to the transformer. It is a delta star transformer, and it is connected to the 400 kV system. Another line is going to the going as a delta star with minus 30 degree phase shift, and it is connected to the transformer AB, that is A side it is connected. From B it is connected to 220 kV, and from 400 kV there is a auto transformer with 0 degree phase shift. It is connected to 220 kV. So for this thing, what you have to think is, for this type of question, first what you have to think is, what is the phase shift required, we have to find out. Okay, whether any phase shift is required or not, we have to find out. In this particular case, already 30 degree phase shift has been given by this transformer delta Y and this delta Y. So here AB should not give any phase shift. So 0 is the right answer, and star star connection is the right answer. Okay, in case if you have any doubt, please contact us. Thanks for listening. All the best for your exam. Thank you.